Hello and welcome to the 15th video of my Left 4 Dead 2 mapping tutorial series. In this video, we'll be going over how to make those cool custom assets like textures, models, and sounds you see in other add-on campaigns. You'll need to download several programs to create these custom assets, that being GCFscape, VTFEdit, Audacity, and Goldwave. They're all linked in the description. Before we start making any custom assets, we need to make a separate game folder in the Left 4 Dead 2 game files so that it's easier to identify where our custom assets are located. In your Steam library, right-click Left 4 Dead 2, hover over Manage, and click Browse Local Files. This will open Left 4 Dead 2's game files. Open the Left 4 Dead 2 folder and open the gameinfo.txt file. Next, scroll down till you see Search Paths. Duplicate the first line that says Game and Update. Change Update to anything you want. Now back in the first Left 4 Dead 2 folder, make a new folder with the name that you put in gameinfo.txt. This is the game folder for all our custom assets. It'll be structured like the other game folders. We're doing this so that it's easy to find any custom assets we make. We'll also be using it later when we publish the add-on. Open the new game folder and create three new folders. One called Materials, another called Models, and the last one called Sound. You can probably guess what these folders are used for. Let's get started with the simplest custom asset to make, textures. There are two parts to a custom texture, the VTF file and the VMT file. The VTF file is the image file. What the texture actually looks like is held within this file. The VMT file is a text file that defines how the VTF is used in game. You can add many parameters into a VMT file to make the texture appear different. When making a VTF, the resolution of the image has to be in powers of 2. The resolution can be 1x1, 8x8, 16x16, 32x32, 256x256, 512x512, and beyond. It could also be rectangular, so 4x8, 32x128, and 256x512 are also valid. I have a PNG here that is 512x512, and I want to turn into a VTF. Open up VTF Edit. Under File, click Import. Locate the image and double-click it to import it. You'll be presented with a new window that shows a bunch of options. The important ones here are the compression methods for the VTF. Clicking one shows a ton of options that are mostly never used. The four most commonly used compression methods are DXT1, DXT5, BGR888, and BGRA8888. DXT1 and 5 are compressed formats, meaning the texture will look a little worse after saving it to a VTF, but the file size will be significantly smaller, almost 10 times smaller. DXT1 is used for textures with no transparency, DXT5 is used for textures with transparency. BGR and BGRA are uncompressed formats. The quality will almost entirely retain from the original image. The file size will be huge. BGR888 is for no transparency, BGRA8888 is used for transparency. In almost every scenario, you'll want to stick with a compressed format, so we'll pick DXT1 for the normal format and DXT5 for the alpha format. Hit OK to import the image. Here it is imported. If your image has transparency and you can't see it right now, go to View and hit Mask to preview the alpha channel. Now let's save the image as a VTF file. Go to File, Save As. Give it a name and hit Save. We just saved the image into a VTF file. Move the new VTF into the game folder we made earlier in the Left 4 Dead 2 files. Move it into the Materials folder. We still need to create an accompanying VMT for this texture so we can actually use it. Right click and make a new text file. Change the file extension to .vmt and name it whatever, preferably the same name of the VTF for simplicity. Open the .vmt in any plain text editor. First line we'll put here dictates the shader for the texture. The most commonly used shader is Lightmap Generic. Put it in quotation marks and type it in. Make a new line only consisting of an open curly bracket. Now press tab to indent and type in $base texture with quotes. This defines what VTF we're using as the base. Press tab again and type in the location of the VTF in quotes. The location is relevant to the game folder. Because the texture is located in the root of the materials folder, we'll just type in the name of the texture here in quotes. Let's say the texture was in a folder inside of the materials folder. We ignore the materials folder because that's the root. We'll just type in the other folders the VTF resides in, plus the name of the VTF in quotes. Make a new line, still indented, and type in $surfaceprop in quotes. Indent again and type in a material surface type. In the description is a Valve Developer Community Wiki page listing over all the surface types you can use. A lot of these may be non-existent for Left 4 Dead 2, but generic ones like concrete or grass are still valid. I'll put in tile in quotes. If your texture has transparency on it, make a new line. Type in $translucent with quotes, indent, and type in 1 in quotes. This option enables translucency on textures when set to 1. My texture doesn't have any transparency, so I'll delete it. Lastly, make a new line and put a closed curly bracket. That's our custom texture. Let's check it out in Hammer. If you had Hammer open this whole time, close it and reopen it. Textures will show up as missing if they're edited while Hammer is open. Search for the texture name and apply it. Great. There are endless things you can put into a VMT to make the texture appear different. Let's look for a texture that we like and we want to copy some settings from. I like the texture called Urban A Brickwall 03A. Let's open it up and take a look at how it was made. Navigate to the Left 4 Dead 2 game files. Source games store all their assets inside of these files called .vpks. We can open these up with GCFscape. Look for the VPK called pack01_dir.vpk. Right click it and open with GCFscape. Press Ctrl plus F and type in urban_a_brickwall_03a to search for it in this VPK. We couldn't find it, and that's because it's located in another Left 4 Dead 2 game folder. We'll just go down the line until we find it. Here we go, it was in Left 4 Dead 2_DLC3. Double click the VMT to open it up. There's a lot of settings here. I want to copy the 3D effect the texture has, along with the small details that it produces when you look at it up close. Copy the lines $bumpmap, $ssbump, and the 4 $detail lines, and paste it into our texture we made before. Now let's compile the map and see how the texture looks in game. Looking up close shows a lot of little bumpy things, and using our flashlight makes it appear 3D. $detail and $bumpmap cause the effects respectively. If you're ever wondering how to make a texture look a certain way, it's always a good idea to look at the textures included within the game and see how Valve did it. The Valve Developer Community Wiki is also a great resource. We can also port textures from other source games. I have Counter-Strike Source's Hammer open, and I found a texture I like called Nuck Met Wall A. Let's open up the main VPK and CSS's game files and search for it. There it is. If we want to copy it, we also have to copy the file path the VMT and VTF belong in. Opening the Nuck Met Wall VMT shows it resides in a folder called DE_nuke. If the VMT references other textures, we need to port those as well to prevent any errors. Luckily, this one doesn't. In the Left 4 Dead 2 files, in the game folder we made for all our custom assets, I'll make a folder in materials called DE_nuke. Now I could just drag the VTF and VMT from GCFscape into the folder. That's it. In Left 4 Dead 2's Hammer, we can now use it. Now let's go over porting a model from one source game to another. I won't be going over how to make models from scratch because it's a lengthy process in itself. If you want to, linked in the description is a great video by another creator that goes over the process. I have a model from Counter-Strike Source that I want to port over to Left 4 Dead 2 called processor.mdl. Again, I'll open up the main VPK for CSS and search for the model name. For Left 4 Dead 2, we need to copy 4 model files over, the first being the .mdl, second being the .dx90.vtx, the third being the .phy, if the model has a collision mesh, fourth being the .vvd. Like porting textures, we need to copy the file path the model resides in. In Hammer, it says the model is in props/de_train. Copy that file structure in our own game folder. Now put the 4 model files into this folder. We need to port the materials of the model too. Open the .mdl file in Notepad or any other plain text editor. At the end of the random mess is the VMT name and the path to the texture. The VMT name is simply called processor. In the CSS VPK, Ctrl F and find the VMT. When you find it, open it up. This VMT references another material called processor_ref, which uses a reflection tinting mask, so we need to port this additional texture over as well. Let's make the file path structure to the textures first. In our game paths materials folder, make a new folder called models. This is where almost all of the textures that models use go. The textures we want to port also sits in more folders, that being props/de_train. So we need to make a folder called props, then inside that a folder called de_train. Select the main VMT the model uses, plus any VTFs it references. In this instance, it will be processor.vmt, processor.vtf, and processor_ref.vtf. Drag it into the de_train folder to port it. That's it with porting the model. In Hammer, we can place a prop static and use the newly ported model. Last custom asset type I'll go over is sounds. We need to use Audacity to make these, along with Goldwave, depending on how you want to use the sound. I've already imported a sound in Audacity.
Fantastic!
At the bottom left, set the project rate to either 44100, 22050, or 11025 Hz. The lower the hertz, the worse it'll sound, but the less file size it'll take up.
Fantastic!
When you've chosen one, go to File, Export, Export as Wave. Under Encoding, set it to Signed 16-bit PCM. Give the sound a name and export it. Now move it to the Sound folder in our Assets Game folder. According to the wiki, placing sound files in the root folder of sounds will cause bugs, so let's just make a new folder in here and place the sound in there, just to be safe. It won't work in Left 4 Dead 2 yet, we have to build a sound cache for it. Open Left 4 Dead 2. In the console, type in snd_build-sound-cache-4-directory, followed by the entire file path of the custom assets folder, including the drive it's on, and press enter. Because we only have one sound in there, the console says we cached one file. Type in quit to close the game. The sound is now cached and can now be played in game. You can see the sound.cache file if you open the sounds folder. In Hammer, you can find and use the sound by opening the sound resource browser, selecting the raw sound type, and typing in the name of the audio file.
Fantastic!
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 If you want the sound to be loopable, we have to use another program called Goldwave to set looping markers. Open Goldwave and drag the sound into the program. Click Cues at the top. Hit New at the bottom left. Under Name, type in start_cue and hit OK. Hit New again, but select Finish Close Bracket Marker. Name it end_cue and hit OK. Hit Close at the top right and save with Ctrl+S. That's it. Rebuild the audio cache again. In Hammer, uncheck is not looped, compile and look at it in game.
Fantastic! Fantastic!
Fantastic! Fantastic! This concludes the 15th video of my Left 4 Dead 2 mapping tutorial series. There are other custom assets you can make like particles, but materials, models, and sounds are by far the most common things any regular mapper would need to know about. Remember to take a look at the Valve Developer Community Wiki and browse through the game files to reverse engineer to see how things are done. Next video, we'll be going over the mission.txt file, which assembles all the maps into one cohesive campaign that can be started from the main menu, rather than the console. Thank you for watching.